one of the inescapable gems of the disco era. Thelma Houston's Don't Leave Me This Way has left its mark as a song that changed music. Initially recorded by Harold Melvin and the Blue Notes in 1975, featuring a vocal by Teddy Pendergrass, the track was a minor soul hit for the Philadelphia group in the US. It was much more of a success, reaching number 5 in the UK. Following Thelma Houston's 1969 debut album Sunshower, which was produced by Jimmy Webb, her major breakthrough finally happened on the fourth album, Motown's Any Way You Like It, released in 1976, which featured the number one disco smash, Don't Leave Me This Way. Hello, it's Warren Hewitt. I hope you're doing marvelously well. Welcome back to another episode of Songs That Change Music. If you haven't already, please subscribe. And if you hit the notification bell, you'll be notified when we have new videos. And of course, if you're into production, you can go to producelikeapro.com and sign up for the email list and get a whole bunch of free goodies. A year following the recording of Don't Leave Me This Way by Harold Melvin and the Blue Notes, the song penned by songwriter-producer heavyweights Kenneth Gamble, Leon Huff, and Carrie Gilbert got a jolt of energy from Thelma Houston when she took the reins and reworked the song into a powerful anthem for the disco era. The year was 1976, and in April 1977, Don't Leave Me This Way hit number one on the Billboard Hot 100 as well as number one on the R&B and dance charts. This was the same year as number ones from ABBA, Dancing Queen, Hotel California by the Eagles, and Sajuke by the amazing Stevie Wonder. This would not be the first time Thelma Houston and Diana Ross's destinies would be intertwined. Another massive song, Do You Know Where You're Going To, was originally recorded in 1973 by Thelma Houston and never released. It later appeared on an expanded version of Thelma's album Any Way You Like It. Motown's Berry Gordy made some changes to Do You Know Where You're Going To, and that became the theme song to Mahogany by Diana Ross in 1975. Not bad company to be among. This was also a competitor against Ross for a Grammy, which ultimately went to Houston for Don't Leave Me This Way. But more on that later. Several of the musicians and vocalists on Diana Ross's Love Hangover appeared also on Don't Leave Me This Way, both number ones and both helmed by Motown Records producer Hal Davis. If there's a remedy, I'll run from it. Think about it all the time. Never let it out of my mind, 'cause I love you. I've got the sweet. Hal Davis was a prominent figure in the history of the Jackson 5, producing hits I'll Be There and Dancing Machine, as well as Can I by the Temptations singer Eddie Kendricks. He led the Los Angeles entity of Motown and later the subsidiary MoWest, which Thelma Houston recorded under. While working on Don't Leave Me This Way, Davis was looking to recreate a similar sound. He recorded at Paramount Studios in Los Angeles, the site of the recording of Diana Ross's Love Hangover. Davis additionally used many of the same musicians, including Art Wright on guitar, Henry Davis on bass, James Gadson on drums, as well as sisters Maxine and Julia Waters on background vocals. John Barnes played the piano, and all the performers infused just the right energy for this disco standout. Maxine Waters, singer and friend of Thelma Houston, also recorded background vocals with her sister Julia on Donna Summer's Bad Girls and Hot Stuff. She recalls Thelma's vocal ability and charisma to be the perfect match for Don't Leave Me This Way, saying, "Thelma is perfect for it. Her energy, her everything. The way she sings, that girl can sing. The energy of that song too, it's almost frantic."
The thing that was in one way was unique about the Motown experience was that a lot of times the tracks are produced, are done, where and the artist is not there. And this was one of those.
Oh, it was?
So that's why I'm saying you might be able to tell me something. And sometimes you might not know who everybody was that was on the album. Now, the producer was Hal Davis. And Hal Davis was one of the producers that I work with when I very first signed to Motown, which was in 1972. And Hal started producing me back then. By that, I mean the quest when I joined Motown was to find a hit. It wasn't about, that was the main objective, a hit. Hit, 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 hit. Not concept, not the artist, what this artist is representing, da da da, and all of that. It was to get that hit. And so Hal Davis was the first person that I worked with when I went to the label. And it turns out that he was the one that finally produced the hit track of Don't Leave Me This Way.
Structurally, the song is everything you could dream of in a disco track, and more, or any up-tempo track for that matter. A stellar power vocal, a heartbreak storyline, irresistible bassline, crying violin and string section, and a twinkling, beautiful piano part. Hal Davis simply outdid himself. So did the band, and the same could be said about Houston's exceptional vocal.
Don't Leave Me This Way was, because you said Gamble and Huff, was Philly International. And it was originally recorded by Harold Melvin and the Blue Notes. Now, how did I get it? Well, Suzanne DePass, who was the head of A&R at Motown and was the person that signed me to the label, heard the song by Harold Melvin and the Blue Notes, and she felt that that song had done in a different, more of a dance, more of a disco beat with a female singing it could be a hit. And she asked me to go and listen to it, and I did, and I liked it. And Hal cut the track. Now, who all was on it and everything and how it went and how many takes and all that, I cannot tell you that because I wasn't there when the track was being recorded.
Well, we cut the session. It wasn't in a Motown studio, and we didn't know we were going to cut it that day. It was no we didn't have a chart or anything. And the producer was Hal Davis, and he came up with the idea because we had heard the record Teddy Pendergrass had done it, and we had a good time recording it. So good. I mean, we were playing I don't know if you could hear, you know, the extended version. You can hear the contractor coming in because he said we was taking too much time. You could hear the door slam. You know, he was cutting the session off. I didn't think nothing of it. Well, you know, I mean, it was a session, and when the contractor came and closed the door because he said, you know, what they were doing then, if you cut over 5 minutes of disco, see, they had what they call 3-hour recording sessions. If you cut over 5 minutes of disco, then that was a session. That's the way the union did it. So we were in the vamp, and you could, I don't know if it's on the extended version, you can hear the door, boom, slamming. He was stopping the session. I remember that. And it became a hit record. And so that was great. That was great. You know, I was so happy for her. But it was, you know, John Barnes, Henry Davis, who's no longer with us. He's with the LTD later on, and me. And we had a good time. And Thelma is such a great person and a fantastic singer. I mean, I've been a fan of hers. Even before I met her, I was blessed to go into the studios and, you know, work for Motown. That was a high regarded position to have at that time. I mean, Motown was second to none as far as the musicianship, you know, in California. That's where I was doing it at. I mean, you had to be on it. You know, that was the school for me. Motown was a school.
Hit-making songwriter Jimmy Webb, who got his start at Motown Records, worked on Thelma Houston's debut album at Dunhill Records prior to this. And years later, when he heard Motown's hit Don't Leave Me This Way, he was not surprised in the least by its success.
Not even slightly surprised. Not even slightly. And when she got into, you know, her kind of gospel things that she was doing, it was like a fish to water, you know, she could do any... I mean, she can literally sing any genre. She can sing anything. And I knew she was going to have success in her career.
One particularly interesting thing about the song is the intro starts off as a minor and then makes its way to a major. So it's like the song is musically and emotionally correcting itself as it goes from melancholy to exhilarating. I can't survive, can't stay alive. The Howard Melvin and the Blue Notes version produced by Gamble and Huff is pure Philadelphia soul, with elements of disco bubbling up. Happy on the horns, hi-hat, with an underlying bass and a call and response vocal harmonies with crying guitars. But the Hal Davis, Thelma Houston version arguably takes the cake. Take for one, Thelma Houston's yearning for her lover throughout the song, beckoning the listener with her cooing mms. Hal Davis's production and Arthur Wright's arranging frame the instrumentation in just the right moments for Thelma and the background singers' voices to shine and vice versa. The exquisite production is a contrast between graceful and intense, from the sweet sounds of the piano to the more dominant bass rumbling throughout, from addicting drums and tambourine to the faint sound of an agonizing horns to showcase Thelma's amplified vocal, which alone is a masterclass in singing. It's a complete rush of every instrument involved, flexing with precision. It's complete with layers of call and response, not just within the vocals, but between the vocalists and the instruments. It's a heated conversation between lovers and a battle on the dance floor. The keyboard kicks off this song with a ballad-like melody. At least you think it's a ballad, it could be. The keyboards continue with a shimmering effect throughout the song, reflecting the most delicate parts of the song, almost like a harp. It is bewitching and angelic. The bass is the instigator in Don't Leave Me This Way. It creates tension and danger and the mischief in the song. After all, this was disco, and it was late nights into early mornings. The bass is what really solidifies the verses, with the chorus joining the song at almost every moment, like a lover on a dance floor. Henry Davis really shines on the second half of the song, where it sounds like a three-way battle for attention between the bass line, the drums, and the vocals. Need your love right now. The drums, hitting at about 120 beats per minute with a glorious hi-hat, are unmistakable for the entirety of the song, except for the brief intro. Along with the bass drum really holds the groove of the song, picking up the intensity by midway in the instrumental. Drummer James Gadson sounds like he got a workout on this song, with a rousing tambourine rounding out the infectious track and keeping the high-energy pulse going until the last beat. The strings, arranged by Arthur Wright, appear throughout the track. They cry, often mirroring the emotion of Thelma Houston's vocals. They live throughout the song in the background, but shine most vividly in the verses, as a sort of call and response to Thelma and the background vocalists. The horns also act as a call and response element to the entire ensemble, with the most prominent part at the instrumental. Arthur Wright's placement of the horns was perfect, declaring their love and devotion. They are the final ultimatum, shouting the song's overall message of desire. The keys are gradually joined by Thelma Houston's lovely mms, while simultaneously the bass line starts gently, reverberating, contrasting the vocal, which is echoed by the tinge of violins. It quickly heads into a furious flash of violins and the keys, and then the magic starts to happen. Don't leave me this way. On the chorus, Thelma is joined by the Water Sisters, Maxine and Julia, for another round of call and responses. Thelma sings and the Waters complete the phrase. Thelma's vocals go from sweet to yearning to chaotic in the best way.
But from someone who enjoys dancing, what that song did for me was that, like, the beginning of the part where she's doing that humming ad lib, the that part, that's like, okay, do you want to dance? That's like an invitation to come to the dance floor, right? So you go out to the dance floor, and then it kind of starts, and then you start your moves, and then it builds up and it builds until you're just going crazy. And that's the, it was a feel, an emotional. It was about emotions. It was an emotion. The emotions were touched, I think, in that. When it was determined that that I liked the song, and that it was going to be cut, then I learned it, and when I and of course I always like to be prepared when I go into a studio. My favorite part of the entertainment industry is the experience of performing in front of a live audience and having that feedback. That's the way I'm old school. That's the way I came up. You know, I can be out working and performing and touring and doing all that before having a record, having a hit record, right? So the art of recording, I've learned how to do it, but it's not my favorite thing to do. So I try to go into when I'm doing the recording part of it, prepared. I know my lyrics. I know what I'm supposed to do. I know, and know it well enough that we can make adjustments when we get into the studio. Like, well, I might like that, da da da, a little bit, blah, blah, blah. But yeah, I knew it, and I loved it because at that time I was rocking and rolling and grooving and going to the clubs and dancing and doing all that myself. So I loved dancing to this song. Once it was finished, I thought, oh my God, this is what they play in the clubs. This is gonna be good. They're gonna love this. They're gonna love dancing to it. That's all I was thinking about. They were gonna love it in the club. They were gonna love dancing to it. And that's where it kind of ended. You know what I mean? I didn't think, ooh, and this is a hit. I didn't put that part with it. I just knew that I love dancing to it, and most people would like dancing to it that went to clubs.
Don't Leave Me This Way went on to win Best R&B Female Vocal Performance at the Grammys, making her the first solo female artist on Motown to win the coveted prize. Houston had previously been nominated for You've Been Doing Wrong for So Long in the same category in 1975, an award that ultimately went to Aretha Franklin. Houston's feel-good Motown song, You've Been Doing Wrong for So Long, was a minor hit, peaking at number 64 in the R&B chart in 1974.
I was nominated before. I was nominated a couple of years before. I was nominated up against Aretha Franklin, and I'm trying to think who else. When she's on it, you know, doesn't matter. Who else is nominated? You know you're not going to win. Although, Don't Leave Me This Way, I think she was one of the nominees as well.
Ain't Nothing Like the Real Thing by Aretha Franklin in 1975 closed out an amazing 8-year streak of wins for the Queen of Soul. And at the 1978 Grammys, when Thelma Houston was nominated again, this time for Don't Leave Me This Way, she didn't even show up to the ceremony. Up against heavyweight competition, again, of Aretha Franklin, Natalie Cole, Dorothy Moore, and Diana Ross, but this time, she won. When Thelma got the call she had won, she was scrubbing the floors of her home.
Why weren't you at the Grammys?
Because I didn't think I was gonna win.
I suppose that's a pretty logical answer when you're up against Aretha, Natalie, Diana Ross.
And I had been nominated before.
Right.
And I was up against Aretha and maybe, I don't know who else before. And it was in New York. I was very excited to be there, and I was excited to be nominated. But then I thought, okay, now that I didn't win that one, so now I don't know if I can sit there. Because you know what happens when they announce who the winner is, and the winner has to walk up to the stage to proclaim their award. It's a little wild, because depending on where they're seated, right? So while they're walking up, they don't want to put the camera on them walking up. They put the camera on the people that were nominated. And so you have to sit there and you have to be
gracious and yes.
Gracious. And I thought, I don't know if I can do that this time. So I'm just not gonna go. Because I really honestly did not believe I was gonna win. And so I was at home and I was scrubbing my kitchen floor when I got the call that I'd won. Because that year, the Grammys, you know how sometimes they give the R&B awards, that sometimes they might be a pre-telecast sometimes. And it depends how it works out. Sometimes it might be they give the country, before. They might give the music, the classical before, whatever. Anyway, this year, they were doing the R&B precast awards. And so I that's how I was. I was there scrubbing. Because I was going to be watching TV. I was going to be, watching it. But that came earlier. And I was like, what? Quick is a lesson to everyone.
Sure.
When you're nominated for something, especially something like that, go. Because you don't want to feel like a fool when you win. And people ask you later on, years later, where were you? Oh, I was at home scrubbing my kitchen floor.
Disco, of course, started out at popular nightclubs in Philadelphia and New York City in the late 60s and 70s as a counterculture to 60s rock music, largely consumed by African American and Latino communities, as well as the gay community, before finding their way to the mainstream. Don't Leave Me This Way, like many disco tracks, became an anthem. It was devoured by clubgoers and radio listeners globally. Don't Leave Me This Way has a cultural relevance that has gone far beyond the Studio 54s of the world, symbolizing the fight against AIDS. Gender is also curiously missing from the song's lyrics, making it a perfect one for anyone to align with or relate to the song, which has only elevated the song's popularity and has made it timeless. Perhaps, since imitation is the sincerest form of flattery, it should be no surprise that Don't Leave Me This Way has been covered numerous times in the style of Thelma Houston's song, most notably by British pop duo The Communards in 1986. It made its way into Baz Luhrmann's Moulin Rouge mashup, Elephant Love Medley, sung by Ewan McGregor, West End and Broadway musical Priscilla, Queen of the Desert. It was covered by Cher during her Las Vegas residency. It was recorded by The Weather Girls. A live bluegrass version exists by Alison Krauss and the Jerry Douglas Band. And the track has made its way into the world of sampling by French multi-instrumentalist FKJ. And most recently, in 2017, by Dutch DJ Bakermat. The Communards were complete fans of Thelma Houston and her hit Don't Leave Me This Way. And in 1986, they released a revamped new wave cover featuring Sarah Jane Morris, which went on to be a number one hit in the UK, even though it only reached number 40 in the US.
Well, let me tell you a funny story. They were in, and we were in, I'm trying to think, I forget the country. But anyway, we were both there at the same time. And they were performing, and I went to their performance. And I told the manager that I was in the audience. Well, they knew that I was there. So they gave me a microphone.
Oh, wow.
And when he started singing Don't Leave Me This Way, I got up from my seat and started, and he was like, oh! He was so shocked.
Oh, my hairs are standing
up. But it was so fun.
That must have been amazing.
Oh, it was. It was so much fun. And it was the best thing. And I felt, I was very happy that he received it so well, and that the audience, everybody loved it. It was fun. It was good production. It was good. I liked it. That, you know, that song, to me, it's been a lot of different people have recorded it, and it always sounds good. I think that's to the credibility of the song.
Don't Leave Me This Way is a song that changed music and will go on as one of the greatest disco and dance songs of all time, reaching international success and crossing musical and cultural borders. On VH1's 100 Greatest Dance Songs, it stands at number 2, just shy of I Will Survive by Gloria Gaynor. I hope you enjoyed the video. Please check out the other videos in this series, and we look forward to seeing you all again very soon. Thanks.